Thank you for tuning in to Upon the Rock broadcast. I'm your host, Pastor Lawrence Shakir. I believe the Word of God will build a godly foundation in the lives of people. There is more available information on our website. You can log on to shakirministries.org. Now, let's go on to today's message.
I got a teaching called the Storm Catcher. Storm Catcher. The Storm Catcher, because if you think about it, there's a lot of people, especially on those, you all remember those videos where they would go and chase after the storm, storm chasers, y'all remember that? They would go looking for the storm, right? And nobody in their right mind would go looking for a storm. But the average people, they don't go looking for a storm, but they, what, go ahead and catch a storm. And it's not like you're looking around a corner where the storm's at, but a storm will come looking for you and find you. And so I think a lot of us in this room, in the body of Christ, we're just natural storm catchers. But what we have to do is learn how to respond in the storm, because the storm will take everybody by surprise. And if you're not careful, if you, the same person who chases after the storm has to buckle down and protect himself as the same person who caught a storm. It's the same exact reaction. But if you kind of just like say, oh, it's nothing, you know, you get those people, they hear a storm is coming and they don't prepare and they get wiped away and their house get wiped away because they just really didn't take it that seriously. It's only because sometimes God will allow, I would say, allowed, use his word, he'll allow a storm to catch you to kind of see what are you made of. Because there's a lot of people that say, I'm with you, or I'm this, or I'm God, you're my heart, you're my everything, but let a storm catch you. Let a storm catch you. You actually see what you're made of. Y'all get what I'm talking about?
That's right. That's right.
Because sometimes people, they do real good until they hit a storm. Then they say, I don't know if I can serve you no more, Lord, because of that storm. So the storm, even though it's bad, it reveals what kind of person you really are. So I go through storms too, but I try to make sure I react the right way. If I say who I think I am and I believe God, that God is having this big, you know, goal for my life or whatever, then I know I'm supposed to face storms. But how you handle it is what lets you know, okay, God, you really got something in me. Otherwise, I'll be blown away. So, Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you, Lord, for this time. I thank you, Lord, for your people. I thank you, Lord, for this opportunity just to teach your word. And as we fellowship and we talk about what you have given us, Lord, help us, Lord, to see you better than what we've seen you before. And, Lord, I just ask, God, that you move me out the way when it comes to this teaching. I prepared and I prayed about it. I studied. Now it's up to you to reveal what you want to reveal to your people. And all these things we pray is in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Go to my next point, please, sir. I like this. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12 through 19, it says, friends, and I like this translation. I think it's the easy to read translation. Friends, when life gets really difficult or when you encounter a storm, don't jump to conclusions that God isn't on the job. See, people like to blame God when they go through a storm. God, where are you at now? All right. Instead, be glad that you are in the very thick of what Christ has experienced. This is spiritual refining process. This is the spiritual refining process. This is how he makes you better through the storm. Now, nobody wants to go through fire, but it's necessary if you're going to be better. Certain storms are on your heavenly calendar and you can't avoid it. You have to just go through it. You have to walk through it like how this guy is just going through the storm. Or you only have to get blown away, but you have to still put your feet down. And the Bible talks about how you have to set your face like a flint. You got to be focused on where you're going. And then it says this is spiritual refining, the spiritual refining process with glory just around the corner. Once you come out of it, you're going to be better. It makes you stronger. It makes your calf muscles stronger. It makes everything about you stronger. But it's the very thing that everybody likes to avoid. So you have to ask yourself, okay, Lord, I know that you have something for me, but if I'm going to go through this storm, I need you to help me be the person, the man, the woman that you want me to be. And I didn't mean to look at you when I said woman. I meant to look at her, but you were just there. And both of y'all kind of look alike in a way sometimes, just a little bit, but she got pretty dimples. All right. So, here's the thing I want you to see. He says you are in the very thick of what Christ experienced. In other words, you're going to learn how to walk just like Christ through this storm. You want to say, oh, Lord, I want to be like you. I want to walk like you and talk like you. Oh, yeah. Well, the storm will teach you how to be just like them. And so a lot of times people, they get confused because I've been going to church. I've been giving my tithes. I've been doing this. How did I get a storm? Where are you at, God? But this is something that you have to, if you're going to get to the next level, every single time God calls you to do something, you can bet that some kind of storm is going to come. So it's not like, you know, you be the kind of people that's like, I'm not going to prepare. If you know that you're going to another level, 2017, Blue's Clue, it's another level. And yes, we believe in for 2017 to be the best year of our life. But don't be ignorant that you may hit a storm every now and then. Okay? But it's designed to make you better. Not to destroy you, but to make you better. Okay? Because I remember when I used to go to some of the sanctified churches, they would think something's wrong with you if you go through a storm. Or the flip side is everybody just think everybody's going through a storm every day of the week. Sometimes people are on the good side. Some people are still going through the storm. But we can't just think that, you know, oh, you're going through. A lot of people are going through, but you're not supposed to stay there when you go through. You're supposed to go through. Just like it says, go through. But don't stay there. All right? So I want to bring that out real quick. Go to my next point. I have two things, and I'm not going to stay too long. I just want to bring this out. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 45, in the same way, you will be acting like true children of your Father in heaven. For watch this, for he gives his sunlight both to the evil and to the good. And watch this, and sends the rain on the just and the unjust. So you could be a good person doing the right thing, and the Bible said that God will send the rain on the just and the unjust. But here's my point, is that when you go through this thing, and some people test it like that, and it'll blow you back. But a lot of times is, no matter what side you're on, we all have to go through the storm alike, okay? And sometimes you all going to be up, you're going to be down. But, and I don't mean to beat this as a dead horse, but the storm will reveal what's really inside of you. It will really reveal that. You will see yourself like, man, I really am strong, because a few years ago, I would have cut somebody out and, you know, did all kinds of stuff, choked them out. But you know you're growing when that same thing happens and you don't react the same way. And that's because the storm has grown you up a little bit. All right. So I'm going to do two different types of storm views. I guess it's two sides of the same coin. And I just want us to both go there. Everybody go to Mark chapter 4. And we're going to just kind of just go to two scriptures. And then I'm going to let you go. I'm not going to teach long. Some of y'all are like, what? You're not going to teach your 45 minutes? No. We're going to kind of just talk about the storm catcher. And then we're going to go ahead and break up and fellowship and love on each other in this beautiful rainy day. That's right. All right. So Mark chapter 4, you all there? Verse 35. Okay. Leslie, can you read 35? And I'll tell you when to stop.
As evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, let's cross to the other side of the lake. So they took Jesus in the boat and started out, leaving the crowds behind, although other boats followed. Mm-hmm. But soon, a fierce storm, bless you, came up. High waves were breaking into the boat and began to fill it with water. Jesus was sleeping at the back of the boat with his head on a cushion. The disciples woke him up, shouting, teacher, don't you care that we're going to drown?
Pause right there, please. Let's look at this scripture one more time, family, as we journey about this storm catcher. Verse 35 says, that day when evening came, he, meaning Jesus, said, let's go to the other side. In other words, it was not their idea to go to the next level. It was God's idea to take you to the next level. He came up with the concept of let us go over to this other side. A lot of times people think, I'm doing this and I want God to bless what I'm doing. And you start thinking that, you know, I'm waiting on God, but actually God is waiting on you, because he said, let us do this. But the Bible talks about right here that leaving the crowd, verse 36, leaving the crowd behind. Sometimes you got to just leave some people behind if you're going to go to the next level. You really got to have the kind of character I'm not trying to say cut people off and be hard to get along with. I'm just saying sometimes you're going to have to leave a certain crowd behind if you're going to go to the next level that God calls you to go to. Mm. And you have to be willing to just leave when he say leave, or move on when he says move on. Okay, watch this. Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was. Now, for some reason, that stood out to me. The Bible says they took him along just as he was. And I don't know why I jumped out, but when I looked at it, I kind of had to put myself in that picture where it says they took him along just as he was. They were outside of the boat doing whatever they was called to do. Jesus was already in the boat. Now, just journey with me a little bit. He was sitting in the boat looking at the other side, and he said, let's go over there. And they said they just took him where as he was, which is already in the boat. My point in saying that is it seems like God was already ready before you were when he was sitting in the boat. And you have to kind of catch up to where he's at, because a lot of times you can be doing something on your own, thinking that you're doing things right. But it's time for you to move on to the next level. And he says that when they took him as he was, where he was already sitting ready for you to come up to where he's at, you have to respond to his orders. Let me say it another way. You could be doing the right thing for a long time and thinking that you're okay because things hadn't been happening, or things are just normal. You got a good job, you got a car, you got this, and everything just fine. And then here come God and say, I need you to do this now. He start putting a burden on your heart that it's time for you to do something else in order for you to get to the next level. So, like every good born-again Christian, we just say, thank you, Lord, I received that. I will go to the next level. Seems good, right? Mm-hmm. All right. So we take him in the boat and we start doing exactly what God calls us to do. As we're moving, doing exactly what God calls us to do, going down this boat, going down this path, going down this, you know, situation, just obeying God, going to work, giving tithes, doing everything you're supposed to do. The Bible says in what verse? Verse 37, what? A furious storm came up. So sometimes you're just doing what God calls you to do, and just by that, storms come. But I like what it also says over here, and I didn't mean to leave this part out, but it says, they took him as he was in the boat, and there were other little boats with him. All right? There were other people going through the same thing. The storm hit their boat, but it didn't just hit them. It hit everybody else too. A lot of times when you hit a storm, it's almost like you just focus on just you. Oh, Lord, I'm the only one going through. But the Bible said there was other little boats too. So they were going through the same storm, but a lot of times we just focus on, I'm going through this thing, you know? But the thing about it is Jesus is in the boat. He said he sleep on the pillow. And I like how it says here that he was sleep on the pillow. And verse 38, Jesus was in the stern sleeping on the cushion. The disciples woke him and said, teacher, don't you care that we drown? Lord, don't you care that I'm going through this? How can the God of love allow me to go through something like this? How can a God of love who says that they love and care for me, allow me to experience this kind of heartache. Don't you care that I'm still going through this? I've been praying to you and I've been fasting and all this, and it seems like you just sleep on me. Mm. I mean, that's exactly what they were going through. These are disciples now. These are not the world. These are Christian people that got questions about God's character. And I think it's good for us to see that transparency, because if they sitting with Jesus, it's like, where you at, Lord? Like T.I., where they at though? If they like that with Jesus sitting in the boat, there's going to be times that when you're praying, you're not going to sense that God is there, or it may seem like he's sleep on you. Right. How in the world I've been going through this long time through this storm, and you're sitting there just sleep on me, and I feel like I'm the only one going through. Forgot that everybody else, there's other little boats going around too. That everybody's going through the same storm, and the Bible says it was a furious storm that did this. Okay. Let's just journey through this real quick, because I want to see one side of just this one storm. And then verse 39, he got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, peace, be still, or quiet, be still. And watch this, I like how it said, the wind died down and was completely calm. In other words, it was like a little lake now. You saw all of this fierce Hurricane Katrina coming in, and all of a sudden he said, peace, be still, and everything just stopped. The clouds rolled away, the little drops of rain stopped. The waves that was going all crazy, everything just kind of died down. And I like this part right here. He said to the disciples, why are you so afraid? You still have no faith. He didn't say you had little faith. He said you had no faith. In other words, the storm just revealed to me that you really don't have the faith like you say you do. Mm-hmm. That's what it's saying. Because, yeah, I was asleep. but you don't even have enough faith to know that I'm still with you. See, people, they look at God another way when they go through a storm. Mm-hmm. And then when God brings them out, which he always does, he looks back to you and says, you know what, during that whole situation, you really didn't have any faith. Mm-hmm. You kind of were just on the boat, but you never did believe me. Mm-hmm. And it kind of shoot holes through your whole faith thing. Like, Lord, I'm with you. I'm with you. And when that storm comes, and when you come out of it, because, oh, Lord, they're going to take the car. They're going to do this. And then they didn't take the car. By the time everything settles down, you look back at it and you're like, Lord, I didn't have any real faith in you. And that's what happens. That's how you have to look at yourself like, okay, Lord, I wasn't as strong as I thought I was. You know, you got to ask yourself these honest questions, because thank God that storm revealed that. Because you're not as, I ain't going to say you're not as saved as you thought, but you're not a super saint like you thought you were. Because the storm just said that. All right. And so they said, don't you care, Lord, that I'm going through this? I've been praying all this time and you're still asleep on me. What kind of God are you? He showed you. And then I like how it says right here that they were terrified, not because of the storm. They were terrified, verse 41. And they asked each other, who is this that even the winds obey him? In other words, God just showed you another side of him through that storm. You only saw him as somebody who just provided the two-piece fish dinner, you know, healed blind eyes. But when he starts stopping the waves and the winds, then you start realizing, oh, my goodness, God is actually bigger than I thought, because we kind of put him in a box if we're not careful, because we've been coming to church since we were little, and we know a little bit about God, and we know that he's a provider and he paid my bills. But you never seen him really kind of just show another side of himself like that. But after the storm, he kind of reveals that, you know what? I'm bigger than what you think I am. Yes. But you can only get that kind of revelation once you go through that storm with him. That's the only time. You can't just get there just by walking with him. You have to go through a storm to see that other side of him. Y'all get what I'm trying to say?
Yes.
And again, a lot of people want to see the other dimension of God. They don't want to go through the storm to see him. I want to know, Lord, that you are a deliverer, but don't deliver me from that kind of, I know you are a healer, but I don't want to be sick. So we shout about that kind of stuff and it sounds real good and people run around the church. But the thing about it is you would not get there unless the storm came. So thank God for the storm. You don't want to go through it, but it's necessary because it's the very thing that's going to refine you. Lord, I want to go to another level. This is the next level, he's saying. Through that storm, when you think that I'm asleep on you, that's when I'm there to show you that, you know, I am closer to you. But do you have the faith to believe, even though you think I'm asleep on you, can you still trust me? Or are you like, I don't know if I can serve you no more, Lord? Because, I mean, let's be honest. Sometimes God don't answer the prayer the way you think he should. The person may die. You may end up losing the house or the job or the divorce. And some people quit on God because I've been serving you, Lord, and you let this happen. I can't serve you anymore. The Bible says you have no faith then. You wasn't really close to me like you thought you were. Y'all get it?
Yes.
So that's one side of the coin. Now let's go to the next one. Matthew chapter 14, verse 22. I'm almost done. This is a quick one today. Matthew chapter 14. Let's go there real quick, family. And if you have it, just say, I have it. Good. Verse 22. Go ahead and read 22, and I'll tell you when to. In fact, yes. Yeah, go ahead and read that, please. 22.
Jesus made the disciples to get into the boat and to go on ahead of him to the other side.
Mm-hmm.
He dismissed the crowd.
Okay.
After he had dismissed them, he went up to a mountainside by himself to pray.
Stop right there, please. Just pause. See, Jesus just got through doing a mighty miracle of feeding the 5,000. And one good thing about Jesus that he wanted us to recognize is that every time there's a big success, you need to go and pray. Anytime there's a failure, you need to go and pray. Any kind of extreme thing in your life happens, the next thing you need to do is, like Jesus did, step aside from the crowd and bury your face in the Bible and just pray, because you got to get refilled for what's coming next. So Jesus, did the 5,000, and I'm sure they want to make him king. But then he sent the disciples away, he sent the crowd away, and then he went and got alone with God. He's trying to show you how to operate when you are walking this thing out, all right? So he got the disciples, he told them to go on while he dismissed the crowd. And so they did that, and go ahead and pick up, right? Just read that verse again where it says he dismissed the crowd.
After he had dismissed them, mm-hmm. he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray.
Mm-hmm.
When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat was already a considerable distance from the land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it.
Pause right there. Okay, so he told them to get him to the other side. He told them to go. And he stayed alone, and he stayed there until it said the third watch of the night in one translation. But it was real late at night. Okay, and so the boat was already a considerable distance amount away, and it said it was buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Another translation, I think it was the Message. I'm not sure, but it says the disciples were fighting against the wind. They were fighting against the wave. They were fighting against the storm, and they were trying their best to do what God called them to do. And when the storm came, they're reacting by fighting against it. And how many of us are like that? Whenever you see a storm, you try to do damage control. You try to fix it, you try to do this, you try to do everything you can, plan, and all that is great, but he's the same Jesus that said, you had no faith when I'm sleeping. Now, he's not even in the boat this time. And now they're out there seemingly by themselves, but they still had a word from God. Go to the other side. If he told you to go to the other side, how many of you know you're going to get to the other side?
That's right.
So the storm's going to come, but their natural reaction was to fight against it. And sometimes we do that. God told us to do this, and it seems like it's not working. I'm going to do it like this. No, sometimes you got to just wait and just let God do that, because he already told you, go to the other side. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times we lose perspective of just that one word, go to the other side. So we fight against things that look like this hindering us. You ain't gonna get in my way. I rebuke you. Listen, you're gonna have to just go through it, because these storms are gonna happen, and you can't start fighting people or jobs or bill collectors. They up there talking about, well, you need to give us our money. And you're like, well, who the blank you think you see, you forget you saved. Because you're trying to fight against the storm, and all you have to do is just keep doing what he calls you to do. And so they up there fighting against this storm. Jesus on the other side of the mountain, and then he said it was a considerable distance away. And I like how it says considerable distance, because there are going to be times in your life, of course, where it seems like God is like far away from you. That he was closer to you in one stage of your life, but then you probably start going through a few things, and now it seems like this gap there. And he's this considerable distance away, but you got to realize he's the same God. He just seems like he's just far away, you know? And that's how some people just think, well, you know what? I need to get back to where I was. You probably shouldn't go back. You should go forward. Because what happens is, even if you're a considerable distance away, God has a way of catching up to you. He can. No matter where you're at, sometimes you can't make your way back. You got to depend that he's going to come and get you. And that's what happens. We always try to get back to, when I was a teenager, I used to be on fire for God. I got to get back to that. No, he will catch up to you. Y'all get that?
That's right.
He will catch up to you. All you have to do is just keep doing what he calls you to do. So they couldn't roll backwards. They had to keep moving forward, but they were fighting against the wind. All right. Alethea, let's read that next verse right there, please.
Okay. And it was during the fourth watch of the night, mm-hmm. Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said, mm-hmm. and cried out in fear.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I, don't be afraid.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, if it is you, Peter replied, tell me to come to you on the water.
All right, pause right there for a second. All right, so I like Peter's boldness. You know, Peter was a loudmouth, but he always got a lot of things done. Mm-hmm. Because he was the guy, and I like people like this, because he take risks. He's a risk taker. And so nobody didn't ask Peter to come out on the water. He was fighting against the waves, and everybody said, that's not God. That's not God. And then he said, if it is God, tell him to come. Let me come out on the water with you, because I see that you're walking on water and I want to be like you. So let me do the same thing you're doing. And you can imagine all the people in the boat saying, that's not God. That's a ghost. You know, anytime again, when God is revealing another side of you, you'll always get somebody that say, I don't think that's God. You know, if you're trying to do something for God and you know that God placed, let's just say you like Peter, he obviously has some kind of impression on his heart that I want to do something more. And the disciples said, no, let's just stay in the boat where it's safe. And he says, no, I need to get out there on the water.
Absolutely.
And Jesus said what? He said, come then. If it's you, let me come. Verse 29 says, come, he said. Then I like this part and people just read over it. Then Peter got out of the boat. You can pause right there. Just that alone, it lets you know that you stepped out and you did something great. All right. Now, keep in mind, this is in the middle of the storm. The Bible talks about that the wind was fighting there. So it didn't say that the wind stopped. It didn't say that the rain stopped. It didn't say the lightning stopped. It was a whole lot of craziness going on. And just like how this picture right here, they were fighting against and doing everything they can and things were breaking and they're trying to hold on for just holding on to God. But then in all of that chaos, Jesus says, come closer to me. And that's where the distractions come in. Because you may say, I ain't got time to come closer to you during this season. Let me fix this first before I get closer to you. And a lot of people start saying, well, Lord, I don't want to come back to church. I don't want to start doing this until I get these things fixed. And then Jesus said at the same time, during the storm, come to me. And so you have to make a decision in the storm. Am I going to just step out in all this chaos? Or am I going to just stay in the boat where it's safe? But in the boat, everything is going crazy as well. It's just that you have some kind of control over it. But out there, you have no control. I hope y'all hear what I'm saying.
Yes.
All right, so watch this. Peter got out of the boat. In other words, he got out of that situation that was normal for everybody else and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. But, everybody say but.
But.
When he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, Lord, save me. As long as he kept his eye on Jesus, all of the chaos that was around him, he can stay above water. But the moment he started allowing doubt and unbelief come in, he realized that if I stay on the path with Jesus and keep my eye on him, I can walk in very things that will drown everybody else. But if you know anything about hurricanes and the storms, where is the safest place in a hurricane?
The eye.
Because all of the chaos is around it, but the eye has all of the, I know y'all already got what I was talking about, don't you? So Jesus is actually the eye of the storm. All of the chaos is going around, but the only way you're going to make it through the storm is you're going to have to keep your eye on the prize or whatever, you know, but you got to keep your eye on him during the storm. And if you do that, you can walk on things that will kill everybody else. But that's another way that I was talking about how Jesus revealed another side of himself. But in this time of the storm, he don't want to reveal another side of himself. He want to reveal another side of you. And I think that's what keeps a lot of people safe in the boat, because you want to just control what you can control in this storm. But during that storm or during that season of trial and testing, you have to look for opportunities where you can get out the boat and trust him on another level. Because
right.
maybe he wants you to get out of that situation that you think, I got this, it's chaotic, but I got this. Maybe he's trying to call you out of that.
Right.
I mean, think about it, because how come he didn't say walk on the water while everything was calm? Why did he choose during the chaotic time to say, now come to me on the water? Because he wants you to realize that without keeping your eye on me during this chaotic time, you're never going to make it anyway. And sometimes just by you seeing an environment that's smooth, you can say, oh, okay, I can walk on the water because it's smooth. But when it's waves and crashing and thunder and lightning, you got all this kind of stuff going on, can you still walk on water like that? And I think that's what he's trying to reveal, is to get you out of that comfort zone. But you need the storm to reveal that out of you. So they caught a storm. And then watch this. You all know the story, of course. What verse we stop off on? He sank. 30. Okay. I'm going to read 30 again. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and beginning to sink. He said, Lord, save me. Immediately. Everybody say immediately.
Immediately.
See, as always, whenever you take risks and you're trying to do something for God and you do fall, because there's a lot of times I've done that. Got out there doing something for God and it didn't work out. But God knows how to, Even if you miss, let's just say you miss God, he knows how to fix it and still put you on the right track and still walk with you on that, okay? So a lot of people are afraid to step out because I don't want to do something wrong. You know, I don't want to get off. I want to stay in the perfect will of God. Well, sometimes the perfect will of God is when you take the risk and you step out there. And if you fall, he's going to be there. It may not have been his intentions for you to do it that way, but you still did it anyway, and he know how to clean that up a little bit. Y'all get it? So don't think that you missed it all the way and God can never use you again. He can still use you, even though you start to sink a little bit.
That's right.
All right? All right, so he said, verse 31, immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. And then watch this. He says, you have little faith. Man, little faith. This guy walked on water, but he said, he's got little faith. I'd rather have the little faith and walk on water like that. It's better than having no faith. Last time I had no faith, but this time I had some faith in the storm. And look at what I did with just the little faith. You see what I'm saying? And I think that's what God's trying to do. He's trying to grow you up that even in all of this storm catching stuff, can you still use the little faith that you do have? Because if you do that, you'll be able to walk on water. All right.
Amen.
So he says, immediately he reached out his hand, caught him. And he says, you have little faith. Why did you doubt? Why did you take your eyes off me during this situation? Why did you try to figure it out yourself by looking at the wind and taking your eyes off the piece of the storm, the eye of the storm? All you have to do is just keep your eye on me and you would have made it. But why did you start to figure it out again, going back to your old ways because this storm has caught you by surprise? And that's what a lot of people do. They're doing just fine. That storm catches them. And now they say, well, I need to go back and do like I used to do. And now you made it worse. He said, why did you do that? All you have to do is just keep your eyes on me and we would have walked together. And then it says right here, you have little faith. Verse, what's the next part? I keep 32. And when they climbed in the boat, the wind died down. This time, when it got back, the wind died down. So at the end of all of this, you know, walking on water and all this storm, by the time you have let's just say you have this kind of connection with him again, the storm doesn't even bother you anymore. It's almost like he forgot about the storm while he was walking on water with Jesus. Then it died down. So some storms may last longer than you think, but you can endure it if you keep your eyes on him during this time. Then it said the wind died down. And then it says, watch this. Then those in the boat worshiped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. I just saw another side of you that I didn't know before. You revealed this part of me that I can do this, but I also saw you as this other part of God. Not just somebody who just keeping my lights on, but somebody who's a healer, somebody who can do this, a deliverer. I see you now in another way, but thank God the storm had to reveal that out of me so I can see you that way. Are y'all get what I'm trying to say?
Yes, sir.
So this storm will catch you, but don't run from the storm. Just go right in the middle of it. But you got to keep your eye on him as you go through this storm, because that's the only way you're going to make it. Because like everybody else, you're not going to look for a storm. You're not a storm chaser, but you are a storm catcher. Say out loud, I'm a storm catcher. Now, I'm not speaking of a bad storm on you, but basically you're going to catch a storm and you got to know how to endure this storm, because once you do, you're going to come to another level. And after that another level, then you see him in another way, but you are a lot better. And then you won't freak out the next time another storm comes, because he already gave you some experience on your belt.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Thank you for listening to Upon the Rock broadcast. If this message has been a blessing, you can help us spread the gospel by sharing this message with your friends. Also, if you're online, please be sure to contact me, either through our website at shakirministries.org or through social media. I would love to hear from you. Together, we can build a godly foundation in the lives of people. Until next time, please know that I'm praying for you, and I hope to see you on our next broadcast.